A quick message from today's sponsor. ExtraVPN offers paid and free accounts, both full of great features that most VPN companies can't offer. ExtraVPN can be found on Android, iOS, Windows, Mac, Linux, and as a Chrome extension. The free version offering 500 megabytes of data in 12 countries, while the premium offers unlimited data in 28. Although bandwidth can be extended on the free version by sharing the company on Twitter. ExtraVPN also offers a subscription to their Netflix servers for $1.99 a month, so that you can watch in the UK or US, depending on which office you prefer. Now, for all you tech nerds out there, here are some stats. The software uses AES 256-bit encryption and has 7 protocols to choose from, each varied depending on use and preference. 15 million people are already using ExtraVPN, so why don't you? Download ExtraVPN and hide your totally safe for work browsing history from your boss today.
Two things. One, that was the last ad for ExtraVPN. Don't have to worry about any more of those. And two, sorry about the echo. I'm currently in the process of repainting my room, and that's why it's quite empty in here. It's 2018, and the S9 Pluses, the S9s, and the Note 9s are out. But as you can probably tell on this channel, we review older hardware. Is it worth going with the Note 8 over the S8 if you're going for that generation? And we're going to work out the differences. So hey guys, my name is Ryan Thomas from Failtech, and this is the Galaxy Note 8 versus the S8 Plus in 2018. And I briefly brought up age there. The S8 Plus and Note 8 were released in April and September of 2017 respectively, and can be picked up for around $350 for the S8 Plus and around $400 for the Note 8. Prices will vary based on condition, network, storage configuration, and where you buy it from. I tend to buy my stuff from eBay. Gumtree is also a great option, and Swapper a lot of people recommend, but I don't personally use it, so I can't give you a good explanation about it. I want to start off this conversation by talking about the displays, which are arguably Samsung's best quality. They make displays for so many other manufacturers as well, it's kind of ridiculous. Poppy, punchy, sharp, and brilliant. These big QHD Plus Super AMOLED displays are stunning. We've got 6.2 inch on the S and 6.3 on the Note. Both share the same resolution though of 1440 by 2960, which is a 19:9 form factor, I believe. The S8 Plus has a more rounded and almost bubbly design compared to the squared off Note 8. That's something that I personally find I prefer with the Note 8. I'm not a huge fan of rounded corners and hugely rounded designs in general. The Note 8 squaring off those corners, not only on the display, but also on the chassis itself, makes it a nicer design in my opinion, but that's kind of subjective. Both have fairly poor fingerprint scanner placements, although I personally prefer the one on the S8 Plus because it's closer to the center and it's not so far off for people who use their phone left-handed or right-handed. It's closer to the center, more ambidextrous. You could probably argue that the Note 8's display is more useful because of that S Pen. I have to say, as a previous Note user, and I use the Note 4, the S Pen is incredibly useful for me, but I know a lot of people who have had their Note 8s for ages and have barely ever used it. It comes out the first couple of days, and at that point, it just stays in the phone. And since these are 19.5 by 9 displays, they feel smaller because they are tall and narrow. So the phone in the hand feels a lot more ergonomic than something like a 16 by 9 display, but you feel like you're getting a bigger screen. This improves ergonomics substantially. Both phones have a taptic lower portion that acts like a fake home screen button. Both feel cool in practice, but I don't know if I'd call them features. Maybe instead like gimmicks to replace a standard home button. The Note 8 has the best display I've personally ever used in a smartphone. And I'll be honest, Samsung often gets praise for their displays, and it can almost feel too good to be true because they get that much praise. But when you use one of these things, you truly know why it's that well respected in the industry, because these displays are stunning. Whilst the gimmicky edge features aren't to my taste, the lack of notch definitely is. So the Note 8 takes the edge from me, but by a hair. Let's next focus on these cameras. I need to close my journal. From the spec sheet alone, the Note 8 takes the win, but that shouldn't mean that we should overlook the S8 Plus. The S7 Edge-derived 12 megapixel sensor with f1.7 glass and optical image stabilization is a setup that I ranted and raved about with my S7 Edge, and it gets even better here. Dynamic range, sharpness, clarity, color reproduction accuracy, and software features are all improved here, and the camera is fantastic. Not pixel level, but a very good camera either way. Moving on to the big boy now, the Galaxy Note 8. The first camera is pretty much the same, and the second is an optically stabilized 12 megapixel f2.4 telephoto setup with a strong emphasis on that stabilization. I know Samsung got a lot of praise for that, and Apple have been doing it ever since. This setup allows for Samsung's live focus portrait mode feature, something that again is kind of gimmicky, but if you really like it, then definitely go for it. I don't tend to use this on any smartphone that I really ever test, but it is there if you like it, and that's something that the Note 8 has that the S8 Plus does not have. Selfie cameras are basically identical with 8 megapixel f1.7 setups. They've got that characteristically nice and wide Samsung wide angle lens. I like it personally, but it's not as wide as the previous generation phones. They both shoot QHD video at 30fps, which is a nice addition there, and the overall camera setups on these devices are good. They're not going to produce amazing portrait selfies like a Pixel, and they're not going to give you like the highest quality UHD front-facing video, but they are solid front-facing cameras. Definitely no complaints. In ye olden days, a Note device meant better than the S device in every single category, and that includes battery life. And unfortunately, for this generation in particular, it's the complete opposite. The S8 Plus has a bigger battery at 3500 versus 3300 on the Note 8, which is bigger in general. And to give you context, the Note 8 is bigger, it's heavier, it's chunkier. But there has to be room inside that phone for the S Pen. The Note 8's 3300 mAh is 200 mAh smaller than the S8 Plus's 3500 mAh unit. Both are smaller than the S7 Edge, by the way. And despite the mere 6% difference, they offer drastically different battery life experiences. Granted, neither are great, but the Plus manages a full day every so often, with the Note failing for me on pretty much every daily test. Granted, these were tested with a good mix of gaming, video watching, social media and stuff, and not everyone is going to have that same workflow. I personally don't tend to watch a lot of video on my phones or play any games on my phone, but it's something that I feel this phone is marketed towards. But due to Samsung's poor optimization, power users should steer clear, although to give Samsung credit, not a lot of phones at this age are going to give that good experience with that kind of workflow. To make up for the lack of battery, however, both offer quick charge 2.0 and wireless charging, which is a nice plethora of features to charge your battery quickly where you otherwise would need to. The performance category is pretty easy because both are rocking the same 8895 Exynos chips here in the UK, with a mix of 4 to 6 gigs of RAM on the S8 Plus depending on the variant, and 6 gigs on the Note 8. I didn't find any speed discrepancies here, although they were both under Android's 8.0 Oreo. Fluidity could be improved with tidier and cleaner software, however I often find that the newer versions of TouchWiz are smoother than they realistically need to be. You'll get lag with almost every 2017 phone, but these really aren't that bad. They're definitely not bottom of the list. Both have USB-C and both have headphone jacks. Both have relatively fast Wi-Fi and 4G connectivity. Both offer IP68 water and dust resistance. Both have a glass sandwich design. Both have micro SD expansion. Both phones are super usable in 2018. And if you really like Samsung and you want one of these phones, but you don't want to spend the extra money for like an S9 Plus or a Note 9, definitely go for these. They are fantastic. Even if I personally prefer the S7 Edge. In general, both phones are great. I know a lot of people very happy with their Samsung devices, the Note 8 and the S8 Plus included. Samsung has continued to break the mold and to prove to you that you don't need a notch and you don't need to get rid of the headphone jack to have a solid IP68 water and dust resistant phone with heaps of features, a heart rate scanner, micro SD expansion, and in the newer phones you actually get autofocus on that front facing camera. Fantastic plethora of features. And that's been about it from me, guys. Thank you all so much for watching. Please do like, dislike, comment, subscribe if you're around here to never miss a video like this one. I want to give a massive shout out to my patrons. You guys have been awesome. And I want you guys to all check out my social media because that would be super awesome too. Again, sorry for the echo. I've been Ryan Thomas with Failtech, and I'll see you in the next video. Peace.